Good morning, everybody. It's very good to be here to introduce our first speaker. I was talking as we were invited by Brian to have a short discussion to Sir Peter about the difficulties of retaining names, which I'm sure some of us at least experience. So I hope I don't forget the name of the speaker who I'm introducing. It's a very great delight to introduce Arthur. And just to say as a prelude, we're making sort of, I suppose, breaking some new ground in that the literature of Irish exile today is going to be focused on cinema and film. So our definition, I suppose, of the cultural expression of a sense of exile has migrated out, if I can put it like that. It's also interesting and good to offer the podium to someone who I think probably qualifies over the 13 years as the youngest speaker to come to the podium. So it's good to hear a new, fresh, mid-20s voice. Late 20s, okay. Minor adjustment. He looks mid-20s, it's the haircut. Arthur has a BA in Journalism and Irish from the Dublin Institute of Technology and a Master's in Film Studies from University College Dublin. He's currently working for the Gaelic Athletic Association as a journalist based in Dublin, but I think probably touring around the country quite a lot. And that having spent some time, a couple of years, living and working in Japan. He's a particular interest in the themes of migration, of English identity in Ireland, and in the history of the Irish documentary. Now, myself and Joanne had the great pleasure of hearing Arthur address us at a lecture, at a conference on the theme of emigration entitled Melting Down, organised again by Tom and Mary in the summer of 2012 at the museum in Cavan, Bally James Duff. And we were both very struck by the presentation that Arthur gave. And I know that you will definitely not be silent after Arthur's presentation. He's addressing us today on the title Breakfast Time Back Home, Media Representations of Irish Emigration. So whether you kicked off the morning with an Ulster fry or a bowl of muesli or anything else, I feel confident you shall enjoy Breakfast Time Back Home, Arthur.
Well, thank you very much, Paddy, for that kind introduction, and thanks also to Brian and to Sir Peter and all the trustees of the Scotch-Irish Trust for Ulster for all this, the support for this event and for the centre here and for all the good things that you do. And thanks also to Ian and Christine in the library for their great help to me today in setting all this up. So, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I'll just explain a little bit about the title. Breakfast Time Back Home. It's originally from an advertisement for a type of bacon in Ireland, Denny's. I think it was Denny's. It might have been Galty, but it's one or the other. And the advertisement was sometime in the early to mid-90s, and the scene opened. Unfortunately, I actually don't have the clip for you. I did my best to get it, but I couldn't get permission from the Great Bacon Company to show it. But the scene opens in what's clearly a New York apartment, and a man is cooking a fry in the early hours of the morning with a New York skyline outside. And a woman comes into the kitchen and with a very strong American accent says to him, "Sean, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. What are you doing?" And he says in a very strong Irish accent, "Yes, but it's breakfast time back home." And it became quite an iconic advertisement and is I think, a perfect starting point for a discussion on, as I call it, the media representations of Irish emigration, which essentially it will be focused on cinematic representations. But the reason for the term media is because there are some television and advertising clips in it. So very quickly, an introduction to what I'm going to be talking about today. Irish cinematic representations of the Irish migrants' experience and how themes of emigration and migration have been represented on the screen, on Irish screens and on cinematic screens over the years. All the way from a film that I'm going to show you some footage from called The Lad from Old Ireland, which is generally regarded as the first true film of this type. In fact, it was quite a groundbreaking film in all sorts of ways, not just its theme, the way it dealt with the theme of migration, but I'll be explaining that in more detail, all the way to more modern films. Then screening Irish America, so how the Irish in America and Irish American culture and third and fourth and various generations have been portrayed in American cinema. And finally, modern media representations, so that will take in the areas of advertising and television and so on and so forth. First of all, as a good starting point, emigration in terms of literature, and as Paddy said, in relation to this conference, we've migrated the definition of literature to include cinema. Immigration is one of the great grand narratives of Irish literature or Irish literary discussions. And I'm going to show you a scene in a moment that perfectly captures what I mean by grand narrative. I mean, a grand narrative essentially is some of the great stories of a country. And perhaps this particular clip, this still that I've taken from the film The Field, the 1990 film by Jim Sheridan, this is the two main characters from the film. On the left, just slightly out of not quite fully in the frame, is the Bull McCabe, played by Richard Harris, and then we have the American Visitor, played by Tom Berenger. And I think before actually I start talking about it, I'll just show you this scene, because this scene sort of fully captures what I'm talking about when I talk about the grand narratives. It's only a very short clip of about 2 minutes long, but in the speech given by the Bull McCabe, all the various grand narratives from the various scope of Irish history, well, one strand of Irish history, are covered.
So she's putting up the field?
That's right. On the first day of October, by public auction.
Public auction? What will happen?
Men will make bids.
Bids? Bids? For my field? Just who would insult me by bidding for my field here in Carrickthorman?
There might be outsiders, but...
Outsiders? Are these the same outsiders who took the corn from our mouths when the potatoes went rotten in the ditches?
Ah, no, bull.
Are these the same outsiders who took the meat from the tables when we lay in the ditches with the grass juice running green from our mouths?
Take it easy.
Are these the same outsiders who drove us to the coffin ships and scattered us to the four corners of the earth? Are these the same outsiders who watched whilst our valley went silent, except for the cries of the last starving child?
The English are gone, Bull.
Gone! Because I drove them out. Me and my kind. Gone! But not forgotten, Flanagan. No outsider will bid for my field. All right.
Okay, so in a very short space of time, he talks about, first of all, the land. And actually, interestingly, later on today, we're going to be taking a tour around the enclosure here, around the old Mellon homestead, and looking at some land that we don't know for certain, of course, but that has been probably reclaimed and nourished and nurtured to the same extent that the Bull McCabe, his family so lovingly tended to this field, this land that means so much to him that he's talking about. He talks about the land, he talks about the family, he talks about migration and the forced emigration that came about in Ireland as a result of the Irish famine. He talks about the British rule in Ireland, he talks about poverty, all those great grand narratives, as we call them, and all in the back against the backdrop of the public house, which maybe in some ways is also a grand narrative at this stage of Irish life, fortunately or unfortunately, with the porter all in the background and so on and so forth. And we'll actually see other scenes with a similar backdrop. Looking at this, first of all, it's a nice starting point for a definition of what a grand narrative in cinematic terms means. A range of themes that recur within these films, of rebellion and sacrifice, of departure and return, of spiritual voyages. These in turn are animated by a panoply of characters, many of them borrowed from the repertoire of early stage and vaudeville representations. So we know the type of characters we're talking about in these cinematic visions. The fighting Irishman, the buffoon, the long-suffering mother, the feisty Colleen, the rebel son. And taken together, these images and themes form the foundation of an Irish cinema. And that's from Ruth Barton, who's a great Irish film academic. And another important point, just before I really get into it, is that when you're defining Irish national cinema, it's obviously quite a difficult thing to pin down. But one of the big things to remember about the idea of Irish national cinema is that for the vast majority of the 20th century, there was no national cinema system as such, in that it wasn't a focus until relatively modern years. So when we piece together the idea of an Irish national cinema, we have to often use cinematic visions of Ireland as framed through other countries. So for example, American cinema and so on and so forth. There's so many themes in American cinema that deal with the Irish, but we have to use their visions and their representations to form our own picture of an Irish national cinema. Now moving on quickly. The first film that I'm going to show you in some detail about this is called The Lad from Old Ireland, 1910. And just to set this in context at the time, by 1910, cinema was really only at its very nascent stage. There had been the recording of moving images for about 15 years to that point. 1896 or so was the beginning of the cinema as such. And it was only in the next 10 to 15 years that actual narrative structures were being placed on films and been made into stories. But The Lad from Old Ireland, well, the people in this shot, first of all, that man on the right is a man called Sidney Olcott, who was a Canadian of Irish parentage. Both his parents were from County Cork. And the woman on the left is, he married her in the end, but she's an actress who worked with his company. And this company who they worked for was called the Calum Company. And the Calum Company were the first film crew ever from the United States to make a film outside of the United States. So this was the first film ever made on location outside of the United States. And Olcott, on the right there, was one of the top directors for this company, Calum. And before I go into this, Calum was a really pioneering company, and there was an excellent documentary made about them last year called Blazing a Trail. It's called Blazing the Trail, the O'Calums in Ireland. And it's really worth watching, because for many years, the Calum Company was forgotten, until in more recent times it's been sort of reappreciated. But The Lad from Old Ireland, anyway, was made in 1910. Olcott, as one of the top directors, was invited to go abroad and make a film. And he was very interested in going back to Ireland, where his heritage was. And so he decided to go to Killarney and shoot The Lad from Old Ireland. And I'll be showing you quite a lot from this film in a moment, but to just explain the narrative of it. Obviously, it's a crude enough early film, so it's a fairly simple narrative, but the lead character, who's actually played by Sidney Olcott, the director, there was only three in the crew who came to Killarney. There was Olcott, the main actress, and the cameraman. The lead character is called Terence. Terence works on the land in Ireland. The conditions are very harsh. There's very little room for any sort of serious economic advancement. Breadline is the essential aim. Terence decides to leave to go to America. He has to leave his girlfriend behind and his mother. Girlfriend maybe wasn't the word they probably used at the time, but he goes to America, makes his fortune, and then comes back. And you'll be able to work out fairly simply yourself from the clips exactly what happens. It is a silent film, of course. So I'm going to quickly show you the clip. But first of all, I'll mention this first, a bit more context for Olcott. Kevin Rockett, who's sort of the founding father of Irish cinematic academia, says, "It's hardly surprising that the films Olcott made in Ireland for his American employers and oriented towards an Irish-American audience should wish to characterize America as the land of bounty, freedom, and opportunity," which you will see it clearly is portrayed as it's seen as the absolute ultimate place to go to try and make a fortune, as opposed to the impoverished and backward places in Europe, in this case, Ireland. And Olcott himself, this is a quote attributed to him. Also, Olcott should say that Olcott was a real maverick figure. He was absolutely pioneering in so many of the things he did, but also he upset many people along the way, not least Catholic priests when he was making his film. The British authorities also came to worry about him in later years because he made a lot of nationalistic films. But he was a real driver of his own publicity, a self-publicist. And as he says here, he addressed 11 groups ranging from 50 to 1,000 in less than 2 weeks in the USA. And as a result, he realized that everyone with Irish ancestry wanted to see the old country again. So this was the starting point, really, for Irish cinematic representations of migration. This film, where he shows the extent to which people wanted to see these visions of their lives, the paths they had made on the screen. So we'll just show this clip. This is just to explain very briefly, Ian. It's the opening 5 or 6 minutes or so from the film, where we see the initial work on the farm and how he progresses from there to the United States. Girlfriend. Well, actually, maybe that might be the girlfriend's mother. I'm not quite sure. The subtitles are in German. That was the only version I could get, unfortunately, but I'm sure you can still follow it fairly easily. Interestingly, one thing about this is that they filmed footage in Killarney. All the Irish scenes are in Killarney. They also, these shots were made on the journey across from the United States, while the shots you're about to see from New York were made in New York. So even for 1910, it was made in three different locations, which is really remarkable, given that at the time most films would have been put together in a day in the same place. So like so many of the time, he finds work as a hod carrier in New York. Meanwhile, back in Ireland. Thank you. please come back to Ireland. And now this is 10 years later, he's made his progressions through American society. To the extent where he's waiting on election results, he's already made his way into the world of politics. And that is actually what happened in the case of so many of the Irish American political families. I mean, it's not that far-fetched. And so we see America is the ultimate land of bounty and opportunity. This man goes from the land where he has nothing other than basic survival, and within 10 years in America he has become a politician. And so it's obviously very positive in its portrayal of America. But at the centre of so many of these films is, and it's something I'm going to return to throughout today, is the overwhelming desire to return is at the centre of everything. Whether it's a romantic desire or even the fear of having to return, that you can't get the old country out of your mind. And the conclusion of the film I'm about to show you now, it's only a minute or so or 2 minutes, is Terence's glorious return, just in the nick of time, actually, as it was, to save the day for his former girlfriend, or perhaps future girlfriend, who is just about to be evicted from her homestead back in rural Ireland. So if you just click that in, I think you've paused it yet. So there's the land agent is threatening to evict them. Good timing, if ever there was. So I'm not actually quite sure what happens in the. I think that's more or less the final shot. That they have a brief moment of reconciliation, but I think there's still the shyness is still there. But as you can see, the lad from Old Ireland is a really important starting point for so many things in the discussion of Irish cinema. But in terms of our theme today, it's absolutely a must. And From if you want to find any more information about the Caelums, you can ask me afterwards, because as I say, that documentary is really worth watching. But they returned to the United States after The Lad from Old Ireland, but they returned quite a bit to Ireland the next few years to make more film. In fact, they made a huge output. At the time, it was the nature of it was that they kind of tended to churn them out. But this was really the beginning and the end of Caelum's interest in the subject of migration. They began to focus on more political themes in the years ahead, which got Alcott, who really was quite a redoubtable figure, into a lot of trouble. But he always seemed to win out in the end, even when he had a run-in with a Catholic priest who denounced him from the altar in Beaufort in County Kerry. For he didn't like the fact that they were filming scenes in the locality, and he complained about there was kissing and going on and this sort of thing. But in the end, Alcott actually got an apology from the local priest, because he went to the bishop, who interceded, and the priest ended up being moved to another parish. So he tended to get his way in the end. And again, the key point to remember about this, and from the next really 30 or 40 years, was these are the most Irish films we have, because there was no actual indigenous industry. These are all American films, and so they're what we have to use when we're discussing Irish cinema. Now, the silent era of cinema, it's not just Irish-American cinema, but in cinema in general, ended in 1929. And just to give you an idea of the amount of films in the period that were dealing with the theme of Irish migrants in America, this is research that's done by, again, Kevin Rockett. And it actually stemmed from, there was a study done on the representation of Jewish culture and Jewish people in American cinema in Hollywood. And according to the research, I think there was about 250 American films which had Jewish characters in it, clearly identified Jewish characters, in that 35-year period, which was deemed in the research to be the most. So Rockett went and did his own research, and he found that there was actually up to 500 films which had identifiable Irish themes or prominent characters. So according to that research, the Irish were the most represented ethnic group in the early years, up until the sound era in American cinema. At the time, there was about 5 million Irish in America, about 20% of whom were Irish-born. And the themes obviously related to the working class, people moving from rural environments in Ireland and farming backgrounds and impoverished backgrounds into an urban wilderness of industry and city living and city life and city work. And so that is absolutely predominantly what the vast majority of, we'll say, those 500 American films dealt with. However, there is a great disparity in a lot of the representations of the Irish migrants in a lot of these films, and we can't obviously go into detail of when you've got so many, but I'll just go through some of the other notable films from the period with strong Irish themes and just quickly explain what some of them dealt with, just to give you an idea of the different types of representations we had. So again, this film, The Irish Boy, is a story of a young man who goes to the United States in hope of work. He is assisted over there by a friend of his who has already emigrated. He gets a job in a factory, but ends up falling in love with a girl in the factory, and the foreman becomes jealous and decides to frame the Irish boy for theft, which he didn't do. However, the girl exonerates him, the foreman is sacked, and the Irish boy and the girl who he has fallen in love with get married, and the Irish boy ends up running the factory. So at the centre of this story is obviously that, you know, if you stick true to the old values of home, of honesty and virtue, you will thrive. However, that's one side of it. In Far From Erin's Isle, it's homesickness is the centre point. A young woman goes to America, Bridget, makes quite a fortune, but becomes very homesick, becomes physically ill and has to go back. In Bridget's Sudden Wealth, another Bridget as the main character. Again, it's another cautionary tale. Bridget suddenly becomes very, very wealthy, but she ends up forgetting her old values, her old value system, and the things that she held dear, is very much a consumer in a consumer society, and ends up losing everything. Similar story in Sweeney and the Million. He is an Irish hod carrier who migrates he becomes a hod carrier in the United States, makes a lot of money, comes into a fortune very quickly, but loses it all, spending it on parties and silly things like that, and ends up returning as a hod carrier at the end of it all. So again, cautionary tales. And so there was quite a difference in some of the different representations. It varied from the glory that an Irish person could achieve over there to the fact that they simply weren't able to thrive over there, or that they didn't remain true to their values, or whatever it was. But the generally consistent theme was that America was the land of opportunity, and it could save most people from the poverty at home. Now, moving quickly on into the sound era and Smiling Irish Eyes, which is a interesting point of departure for discussing Irish American cinema in terms of the sound era. Smiling Irish Eyes generally would have been forgotten in the great canon of American cinema. It was a fairly simple story. The story was of a man who works on a peat bog in Ireland, migrates to America, leaves his girlfriend behind. She follows him back over to America, unbeknownst to him, and sees him in a theatrical production kissing a girl, and is distraught and goes back to Ireland, thinking that it's all over. He goes back after her, they end up reconciled and return happily to America. Fairly innocent stuff, fairly simple, would have been forgotten, apart from the fact that this was the first sound film shown in Ireland with Irish-American voices in it. And it was hugely controversial in Ireland when it was shown in the Savoy Cinema in Dublin. There was wide-scale protests. It was very poorly received in the media. It was seen as stage Irish. The Irish representations in it were seen as notoriously stage Irish. And it led to a charging of the screen in the Savoy, where a number of students from University College Dublin, which actually included a future president of Ireland, Carvalho Dálaig, and Cyril Cusack, the soon-to-be very renowned actor, were amongst the group who protested against the film. And one of the other major reasons why it was so controversial was that there was a scene in it where Colleen Moore, who played the main female lead, is seen playing with pigs, which was seen as a notorious Irish stereotype and an absolute downgrading of Irish people. And I don't know where it came from. I'm not actually sure where that stereotype came from, but that was another major reason. But the main point was the actual accents. People had a problem with hearing these sort of pseudo-Irish, pseudo-American accents on the screen, and a lot of these people would never have heard these kind of voices before and just thought it was something that wasn't credible and wasn't particularly appealing to them. And as we moved on into the sound era, a lot of the themes which defined Irish-American cinema in the early years, so such as simple themes of departure and exile, going to America, finding work, coming back perhaps, a lot of those themes disappeared as the migration numbers to the States dwindled, as less and less people went, even though it was obviously still very high in those years, it wasn't to the same extent as it was in the early years of the century and before, the themes tended to change. And it became more, Irish themes in the cinema at this point, in American cinema, became more identifiable by the ethnicity of the characters rather than their actual story. Most of the characters were actually, at this stage, American natives, or well, American-born citizens, but with an Irish background. And this is perhaps best encapsulated in the Irish gangster genre, which began in the early 30s, and The Public Enemy, which is one of the best known of this type. Now, you might recognize the man on the right there. That's James Cagney, who was an Irish-American actor and was one of the great actors of his time in the United States. And this actual scene from The Public Enemy is very famous. It in 1931, as an interesting point to note, was what's known as a pre-code film. And what that was in the early 30s, when the American Catholic Church became more powerful, they wanted more regulation of the film industry. They wanted less violence on the screen, less controversial themes. But they didn't get a proper code of administration of this until sometime into the 30s, an actual industry regulated code. So what you will actually find is a lot of films from this era are a lot more violent than ones that came later. And this scene is particularly famous because he puts a grapefruit into his girlfriend's face at the breakfast table. So sticking with the breakfast theme, that's actually a breakfast table that scene happened at. But by this point, as I was saying, it was more the ethnicity of the characters that identified them as Irish. And we will be returning in a few minutes to the actual Irish-American cinema. But now moving on to, I suppose, what is really the main part of any discussion on Irish migration and themes of emigration in Irish cinema is The Quiet Man. The Quiet Man, which I'm sure many of you have seen and certainly have heard about, was directed by John Ford, who was an Irish-American director, a legendary American director in his own right, and is one of the founding, certainly one of the major figures of American cinema. But in the context of Irish-American cinema, he is the major figure. And, well, The Quiet Man, in some ways, is controversial, but in other ways is much loved. Controversial because it's seen as quite, its representation of Irish life is seen as utterly unrealistic, utterly romantic. A lot of the contemporary views at the time and a lot of the subsequent discussions have centered on how it creates essentially a world that doesn't exist and never did exist. That was a dreamlike world for which Irish-American exiles or people of Irish extraction in America could place their fantasies and imagine that this world existed and that it was something heavenly, but that maybe wasn't quite there. But on another level, it's also a world that they could dream about, and it's also a much loved film because of that. And a huge part of The Quiet Man is the landscape and the depiction of the Irish landscape as a sort of an almost unreal place of verdant beauty and heavenly visions in the fields and so on. And this is, again, going back to Ruth Barton, she's commented on this in how this influenced many Irish films, the importance of the landscape and its portrayal. In the Irish context, the extraordinarily picturesque and photographic quality of the landscape has combined with an immigrant culture predicated on nostalgia and a history of tourism to endow the romantic vision of the landscape and its people with an enduring potency. So in other words, creating a vision of Ireland which makes the whole country an almost heaven to someday return to or maybe visit for the first time, whether it's real or not, portrays Ireland as an idyllic rural Eden, left behind by those who left, but hopefully there to be returned to someday and luxuriated in, a sort of paradise regained. So paradise was lost, but paradise may still someday be regained. And another critic or another academic, Luke Gibbons, describes it as a dream world of stage Irishry and nostalgic sentiment. And there's a couple of scenes that I'm going to show you from The Quiet Man, which really captures exactly what I'm talking about here. But the really important thing to remember about this is while The Quiet Man was criticised for this supposedly unrealistic portrayal, at the heart of The Quiet Man is an understanding from the director John Ford that that's exactly what he was doing. To leave it ambiguous, in other words, there's a nice quote actually that perfectly captures that it's a playful acknowledgement of the perhaps fictional nature of how real or not what we're seeing is. That the film always blurs the lines between is this a real vision or is it just something that's in the eyes of the American who's seeing it. And just before I show you the clips, I'll quickly explain for those who aren't familiar what the actual story of The Quiet Man is. Sean Thornton, played by John Wayne, was born in Innisfree, where it's a fictional place where the film was set, but he left at a very young age as a toddler, went to the United States with his parents, and became a boxer in the ring in Pittsburgh and worked in the steel industry over there, I think. However, he ends up killing a man accidentally in the ring, and so he has this dream to return to Ireland to cleanse all the bad things that have happened to him in the States. And this scene that I'm about to show you is where it's very, very early on in the film. He's arrived in Innisfree, Innisfree is the name of the homestead, in fact, rather than the actual area. The area is called, I think, Castletown. And he's been driven towards the town and he sees the home place where he grew up in. And we'll watch the scene first and we can talk about it afterwards.
Don't you remember, Seanine, and how it was? The road led up past the chapel and it wound. And there was the field where Dan Tobin's bull chased you. It was a lovely little house, Seanine, and the roses. Your father used to tease me about them, but he was that proud of them too.
Ah, that's nothing but a wee humble cottage.
A little place across a brook. That humble cottage. Who owns it now?
But the widow to learn. Not that she lives there.
Think she'd sell it?
Who'd use it?
I'll bet on it. Because I'm buying it.
Now, why would a Yankee from Pittsburgh want to buy it?
I'll tell you why, Micheline Old Flynn, young, small Michael Flynn, who used to wipe my runny nose when I was a kid. Because I'm Sean Thornton, and I was born in that little cottage over there. And I've come home, and home I'm going to stay.
So, home he's going to stay. So, and what I was talking about earlier about that the film plays along with this acknowledgement that the lines are blurred between reality and fiction. If you notice when he's sitting on the bridge, and it's a point that's been made by countless film academics in relation to this film, is that the backdrop is actually not real. It's literally not real. He's in a studio. And it can be interpreted, if you want, that what we're seeing in this beautiful dreamlike vision of the cottage in this beautifully verdant place is that it's only through his eyes that it's perhaps not really there. And even the fact that he can hear his mother's voice in the background, his mother who's now dead, makes it even more unreal, that this is something that's in his mind, certainly, whether it's there for everyone else or not, isn't quite clear. But the important point, I suppose, is that it was, when Irish-American audiences were watching this back in the States, it was there for them too, because The Quiet Man has gone on to become one of the most loved films of the diaspora in America for that very reason. Now, I'm going to show you another clip from The Quiet Man, which is, again, along the same sort of lines of reality or otherwise, and the perfect vision of Ireland. Is that real? She couldn't be. It's a scene where Sean Thornton, again, it's actually just after that clip I've just showed you, he continues on his journey towards the town, and he takes a brief stroll when he suddenly sees this vision in the fields. And I'll show you that in a moment, but there's an interesting quote from, again, from Luke Gibbons, that it's a world of fantasy, essentially. An Ireland where the sun is always shining, and where, crucially, there are no great worries, unlike there are in the American industrial life. It's a rural world divested of material cares, in which people spend their time singing, drinking, and fighting. And that is essentially what happens in The Quiet Man. It's singing, drinking, and fighting, and very, very rarely with any great seriousness. At the centre of it all is fun and simplicity, which I'm sure to anyone who lived in Ireland in 1951 would probably say there was a lot more went on than that. So here's this clip, which I'm about to show you, which, again, along those same lines. So please play.
Nonsense, man. It's only a mirage brought on by your terrible thirst. Come up, Napoleon.
So, again, that playful interrogation, he literally, and even just before we see the girl, you hear that little tingle of music as if it's like magically appeared. I would ask you, I mean, does that look real to you? I don't see too many sights like that when I'm going around the country. But at the same time, he still sees it. So whether it's real for him or not, who knows? But again, the important thing to remember is John Ford was completely aware of this when he was making the film. These are all very much there to be seen and to be interpreted in the way the characters see it. He's very much aware of the fact that is it a mirage? Perhaps it is. Now, moving on from The Quiet Man and back to a film I showed you a clip from earlier, The Field. The Field was made in 1990, and it directly inverts so many of the themes of The Quiet Man and completely transforms them around. Whereas The Quiet Man is a glorious return, a beautiful heavenly world. Ireland is a beautiful heavenly world. All those themes are inverted, and even though the central story is the same, of an American coming to Ireland to buy land, and being somewhat disrupted in his way, the actual way it's interpreted couldn't be any more dark and different in Jim Sheridan's The Field. And Jim Sheridan himself, the director, is on record as saying that he wanted to take The Quiet Man and absolutely turn it around and portray a totally blacker version of the returning emigrant. And again, it's the theme of land and place and desire to return is at the centre of it. But the consequences of that return are so different. And migration is not seen in any glorious terms in The Field whatsoever. It's seen as an absolute necessity and something which has got dark consequences for the future, as directly happens in the field. The clip I'm about to show you is a very short clip, but it's a very useful clip. Unlike in Quiet Man, Sean Thornton was actually born in Ireland, but he effectively is an American. In The Field, the character is completely American. He's never been to Ireland before, played by Tom Berenger. And in this scene, he's talking to the local parish priest about his plans for what he wants to do with this field he hopes to buy. And he talks about his father, who was Irish, and how the desire to return for his father was the opposite of the one that's in The Quiet Man. It wasn't that he overwhelmingly wanted to go back to Ireland, but the shadow of Ireland never left him for his life, for better or for worse. And he as a result, was a lonely man all through his life, as the character says. So we'll just play this clip with the American and the parish priest.
Your plans are noble, Peter, but people don't like change. I'm worried.
You only see the past, Chris. I see something else.
Can you see it somewhere else?
Look, Chris, my father was a lonely man. I spent my childhood dreaming of finding his father for him, of coming back to Ireland and bringing my grandfather back to life. Then my own father died, and I just had to come back. Can you explain that to me, Chris?
So it's an altogether bleaker vision of the returned emigrant. It's certainly not Colleen's roaming through the pastures with sheep and beautiful scenes surrounding her. Even the colouring of the film throughout is much darker, and it is. As Jim Sheridan intended, a darker version of the returning emigrant. So as we see, the American is not romantic about Ireland. His only reason for buying the field is material. He wants to make money, he wants to make progress. Also throughout the film, Bull McCabe refers to emigration in an utterly negative light. Everything is the black side. He talks about the coffin ships, his siblings been forced to emigrate. And his own son, Shamey, committed suicide because of it's interpreted in the film that it was because of the fact that Bull told him the land could only go to one of his two sons. One of them would have to emigrate. And this pressure bore down on the eldest son to the extent where he took his own life. And that's the story at the heart of the Bull McCabe's trauma is this incident. Now, moving on from those earlier films, and we take a fair leap forward, and the first look at Irish migration to Britain, and it's a film called Kings from 2007, based on a play that you might know called Kings of the Kilburn High Road, and it's a group of Irish friends who emigrated from Connemara 30 years previously, and it's set at the wake. Most of the film is related to the wake of one of their friends who originally emigrated with them in the 70s, who has died, and they're all meeting up again and reflecting on the lives they've had in Britain after 30 years. And it's essentially a story of, well, many stories, but Irish identity and the various identities of the emigrant, and the sort of, it's a theme that returned throughout the film, the fluid identity of the emigrant, that is, they're neither one nor the other, neither Irish anymore, but not quite British, that they're, as the line is used in the film, a tribe of their own, a different tribe altogether. And again, in this, there's countless discussions in the film where they talk somewhat unrealistically about, oh, should we go back to Ireland, even though they've been 30 years in Britain, and many of them have absolutely no prospects of not only work in Britain, but certainly not work in Ireland. And the scene I'm about to show you is at the sort of end of this very boozy wake. Two of the sort of most down on their luck characters are talking about possibly returning to Ireland, and one of the slightly more successful of them sort of brings them back to reality. And it's in Irish, of course.
I'm here to go share a guilty tiger show, Salma Alien Shea.
Share a walla. A walla Mahoon.
Heard?
Oh, squealy.
You're a bucky, laggy. It's kind of hacking it's in the air if you got a walla. Should you a walla? I'm sure.
So, phobe.
Passed the market to Gestam. London, Hasna.
Come on, let's go.
To the Imbalinish.
Where's the sleds?
Tommy didn't Argonian show. What news if we didn't have our honey with Riavenaden?
So?
So?
So it's fucking British, man, huh?
That would be a bit colourful. And Leonard the Dream, through the hack.
Only go lane on team. I was just like crowd, my yeah. Now call it off in global economy.
It's very annoying to want to read and bale. It could be Aiden and Bale and Argry. I guess then shot on fear while.
So, you should show a vest with good young, being a talk to all.
Shame.
See the shop and toss up, whack.
Can I vest toss on, Sean?
I know. Tommy Gilligan, sugar, come, Tommy.
Granny, tend the nan. Tha gold sheer, not Jackie Flanagan. Was that she's with her about a sheer nocht?
Jay?
So Kings primarily deals with the sort of hopelessness of return. So it's sort of the hopelessness of return, that it's unrealistic and that it's simply not something that's not going to actually happen. And even though the characters talk about it and dream about it, it's not a realistic dream, and they know that themselves. Interestingly, this is one of the few films that actually deal with Irish migration to Britain. Almost exclusively in cinematic terms, it deals with Irish migration to America. Even in an Australian context, there's very, very few films that deal with it. I think maybe it's probably because most of the cinematic issues have been preoccupied with the political when it's between Ireland and Britain, and migration has been sort of somewhat secondary, perhaps because it's also so ubiquitous, it's not seen as something that you can really dwell on too much. Now, I probably don't really have time for this. This is only a very brief overview of, you know, in modern times, the Irish American on screen, when it gets through the different generations of ethnicity of the Irish Americans, that by this stage, Irish American representation on screen, it's only really identifiable by surnames. That's how you know that you're dealing with Irish teams. But just as a starting point for this, I think it's a very interesting quote from the actor Errol Flynn. And this is reference in his early years as an up and coming actor, about when the idea of being ethnically Irish, not really dealing necessarily with an Irish story, but just that the character you're watching in a movie was Irish, was a popular idea, and that would attract Irish Americans to watch the movie, even if it didn't actually have particularly Irish themes in it. Sam Clark came up with the idea that I should be billed as an Irishman from Ireland. He had me photographed as a motorcycle cop. That fitted into the American conception of what an Irishman fresh in from Ireland should look like and be. You were assumed to be Irish, your name being Flynn. And that was how I got my start as an Irishman. Nobody knew or cared that my whole life was spent in Tasmania, Australia, New Guinea, England. From then, for a long time, nobody believed me when I talked about that background. They didn't want to hear of it. They wanted me to be Flynn of Ireland. And I think that's worthwhile in remembering when we talk about the idea of the Irish American on screen, that very often it was simply a commercial thing to attract Irish American audiences. And as the years went on, the teams became less about their actual life and simply about their ethnicity as a marketing tool and a marketing ploy. And a very quick quote from Kevin Rockett there about the history of representations, that it was the gradual change from crude early stereotypes to themes of Irish migration to the point where characters were simply identified with their names, and that was the starting point and the finishing point to make a film have an Irish theme. And there's just a list of notable Irish American films down the years. I'm sure you know many of them, and it's something that continues to this day. The Departed is obviously a recent example, dealing with the crime world in the Irish crime world in Boston. Million Dollar Baby has Irish themes. Gangs in New York, historical Irish themes. All, and then the early Irish gangster films from the 30s. And it continues even with, some of you might be familiar with the HBO TV series Boardwalk Empire, which is very popular at the moment, and that has countless Irish themes in it. So it's still a popular creative theme to deal with. Now, getting close to the end now, and that's the end of looking at the cinema, but I just want to finish by looking at another area in which migration has... And the theme of Irish emigration has seeped into the Irish popular culture, And the sort of, I like the term, the visual vernacular. In other words, the sort of language of what we see in terms of on the screen and in advertising, which is the real, very often the key to knowing what are the themes of popular culture. You'll find them very quickly when you look at advertising. And I'm going to just start by showing you this clip. It's an old advertisement from the 1980s, the 1990s. I remember it as a child from the early 90s. And it captures exactly what I'm talking about. So just play that in. That's from the old ESB, the old Electricity Supply Board in the Republic. And yeah, as you can see, at the centre of it is emigration. I mean, they can turn an ad about electrical appliances into a theme of emigration, but it's just so identifiable at the time to people that was probably the procedure that so many mothers and fathers went through as their children returned from Australia or from America or wherever it was for the first time in a long time, that they would be getting the house ready. And another one from a slightly earlier era in the 70s, which is another interesting way of looking at it. And I have another one subsequently to this, which is an interesting progression on this theme. But this expression, Sally O'Brien and the way she might look at you, has become quite a famous one. And we'll just play the ad and you'll see.
What I miss about home is the rain and the greenness and the pint of harp. And the evening before us, and friends coming in, and the pint of harp, and Sally O'Brien and the way she might look at you, and joining the chorus, and the pint of harp. All the money is good and the suntan is free. You could fry an egg on the stones here, if you had an egg. And you could certainly sink a pint of harp, if you had a pint of harp.
So home is where the harp is, and it's a great ad. But again, Sally O'Brien is not much different from Maureen O'Hara in The Quiet Man. It's the same dream-like vision that's back there somewhere that will just lure you in when you return, and it's almost like it's not real. Even that little glance in the pub, it's not quite real. And it's all in his mind, no more than John Wayne in The Quiet Man. It's something that he dreams up, literally, in the ad, he dreams up. Now, this Sally O'Brien, I think it's really interesting, this next ad. That one there is from, I think it's the late 70s, early 80s. But this next one is from the late 90s.
Dear sis, everyone's delighted you're coming home. Mum's tearing the house apart in your honour. She's even painting your room, though I think that's meant to be a surprise. Remember John O'Brien? He split with his girlfriend, so he's all yours. He was asking for your Friday in O'Shea's. Shep misses you like mad. And Dad says you'd swear he's checking every plane that flies over. Nothing much else happening. I'm just sitting having a cup of Barry's tea. A bit different from New York, I bet. Lots of love, Angie.
So it's John O'Brien for the more modern audience. It's changed. I heard it commented about that ad once that they didn't realise everyone in Ireland was now a model, which is probably quite noticeable about the ad. And then one final ad to show you, which is from the more recent trend of emigration again, from 2009, for another one of those great migratory products of Irish consumerism, Kerrygold, which has travelled as much as any as much as any Irish emigrant. So this is the more how it's still a theme that advertisers return to time and time again. And this is just one of many examples I could have showed you of how it still remains a central theme in advertising. So if you just play that one there, Ian, it should come up.
Diana.
Oh, Mr. Harmon.
Pass the butter over. Angela will miss your cooking in Berlin, but at least we have Kerrygold there too.
Water. Export all our best stuff.
Okay.
Safe turn.
He'll be born in Germany, but his feet will touch Irish soil first.
It's amazing how good they are, isn't it, at making ads? But yeah, so as I said, the visual vernacular, something that they can return to and immediately an identifiable theme which people connect with and which clearly works for them. And as I say, these are just four examples, and there are probably 50 or 60 I could give from different generations of how it's been used. Now, there's just one final clip I want to show you today, and it's neither advertising nor cinema. It's from the TV show some of you will probably be familiar with, Reeling in the Years, which is an RTE which takes a year and goes through all the news stories from it and mixes it in with contemporaneous music. And this clip I found, it was just a really fitting clip, I think, to conclude on. It's from 1986, and it's a collation of news images on the theme of emigration, which was rampant at the time. And the song that you'll hear in the clip is As I Leave Behind Nadine, sung by Mary Black, an emigrant song, and Nadine being the Irish language for the town of Kenmare in County Kerry. And we'll just play it. These are some useful links that you might like to investigate further, just for modern media takes on emigration. I can show you them at the end if you want to get them. I can leave that page up when the lecture's over. But just to finish on this clip from 1986, Reeling in the Years, again, that theme I'm talking of, the visual vernacular, how it all comes together to form an image that we're all so familiar with to the extent where it just seeps in without anything else happening. So if you just play that, Ian.
For the last 2 years, we in the GAA in County Sligo have noticed that there's a great increase in the amount of players leaving clubs here and going to places in Britain and in North America. I would say that all our clubs have been affected to some extent, although the rural clubs have certainly suffered the most. I could instance certain clubs such as Eastkey. Eastkey have lost 15 players. Now that in GAA terms constitutes a full team, and it's very difficult for any club to keep going under those circumstances.
As I leave behind, it's like purple splashed on green. My soul is strangely fed through the winding hills ahead, and she plays a melody on wind and streams for me. Won't you remember? Won't you remember? Won't you remember me? And we wind and climb and fall like the greatest waltz of all, float across the floor, her sweet breath outside the door. And it's time that I was gone, across the silver tear.
Unemployed now for over 7 months. Can't get on in this country. So I'm heading for England, hoping to get something there.
You're off to London now on the super bus. Do you have many friends and relations in London?
Yeah, brothers and sisters over there, and cousins over there. They said that's trying to fix a job in the government.
Are you trained in any particular skills, lads?
No, no, whatsoever, no.
As I leave behind Nadine in the hall where we had been, rhododendrons in her hair, in the mountain scented air, I still feel the spirit song across the silver tear.
Off they go. So the mode of transport might change, or the years might change, but the theme stays the same. And even we notice a lot of the coverage nowadays of emigrants going, young emigrants going, is follow similar lines to that clip we just showed. So I hope you enjoyed that, and that's all I have. And if you have any questions, I'd work away. So thanks very much.
It struck me that it was, you know, it didn't only affect Ireland, it's how you deal with the past.
Yeah.
I mean, we all would have a view of our past or our family's past, and, you know, this can be romantic or it can be some hurt that was there. And going back, it's never like our view. So it's just how we think of the past, how we like to think of the past.
Absolutely, yeah. It's the central theme of it, like the returning to the past, recurring for better or for worse, that you can't escape it.
Yes.
You know.
Thank you for that lovely presentation. I was thinking about what percentage of the American population at that time would have had heritage?
We'll say at which time?
At 1930s, 50s. You know, obviously it was... people were making films for particularly the Irish population. So, what percentage of?
Well, I think they say today 70 million, isn't it? Is the general term for today, for the diaspora. But at the time, I actually have a little bit of information, statistical information in it. I think they said that what percentage of the overall Irish diaspora in America?
No, what percent of the American population were of Irish heritage?
I think you quoted.
There's a figure there that I just want to get to. Yeah, there it is. There was 5 million Irish in America at the time, and 20% of them were Irish born. The population of America at the time, I'm not sure what would it have been in 1925 or so.
Yes, but of the whole lot of them, how many? It's not 20% of America.
No, but there was 5 million Irish in America.
But how
so,
many?
Well, I suppose it must have been 100 million. So, could have been. Mm. I really don't. I should.
One in four or five? Are you
no, it wouldn't be that high. No. I do know. It was 6%. It was
6%.
It was 6%. Yeah, it was 6% at the time. I remember in relation to this quote, it was about 6% of the actual American population. This group here, the 5 million Irish.
I read that. Yes.
Was 6%. Yeah.
Uh huh. So it was quite a small percentage for the number of films which were added Irish.
Absolutely.
But just to say that if you take into account second. Third generation, particularly the post-famine surge of immigration, you're looking at a much, much bigger group of 20 million plus as a ballpark figure. It's 44 million by the census of 1981, and so it's a much, much bigger group if you include not just Irish-born, but second and third generation. Well, again, if your definitions, to incorporate those with an Ulster Protestant.
Yeah, I'm not sure what their definition was for that. I just was Irish. That was the only word I saw.
Mm-hmm. But it's true, Arthur, isn't it, that the market for these films wasn't, it wasn't just Irish people or people of Irish heritage who were attracted to this, because you couldn't be making films about every ethnic minority.
Well, the thing is as well, one of
the Irish became kind of emblematic of all the emigrants.
Well, one of the common themes of a lot of those ones was that it was the Irish mixing with other ethnic groups. For example, that became a common genre of the time was the Irish man and the Jew. That a lot of films would, I mean, there was the Coens and the Murphys was one example, that it would be two families living side by side, a Jewish family with their Jewish traditions and an Irish family, and it would be the it was always comic, the various, usually the story would be that the daughter from one would marry the son of the other, and that the various complications that ensued. So absolutely, the Irish were sort of seen as the starting point for a lot of the general ethnic discussions. And Italian, I'm not quite so sure. I think it wasn't to the same extent back then, even though in more modern times they've come to dominate the representations. I think you're absolutely right, yeah. It was the Irish and the Jew were the two that were yeah, the most popular.
The thing about the Irish is that they have the English language.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the, whereas if they would have been making them for the in Yiddish or in Italian, the market
exactly
was limited to the ethnic group, but the Irish could be emblematic.
The only thing is, in the silent period, language wasn't as much of a factor.
Yeah.
You know, not being smart about it, but like it was, even though you had the subtitles and stuff.
That's true.
But in the certainly in the years later, yeah, I suppose it wouldn't have been as much of a thing.
Yeah.
But in the silent era, that wouldn't have been a factor.
No. But I was interested when you showed the James Cagney, and a lot of those early James Cagney films, he was a gangster.
Yeah.
And given his obvious ethnicity, he was an Irish. I mean, he wasn't being passed off as an Italian gangster.
No, not at all.
But there doesn't seem to have been the same. The Italian Americans have objected very strongly to the gangster reputation of the Italians, but there doesn't seem to have been quite. The Irish seem to have embraced how they were represented.
Well, I think you're right. And what actually happened at the time, which is, it's really interesting looking back at it now, but in, for example, The Public Enemy, I should have said it at the time, there's not really any discussion of Irish teens, but the family are very, they were chosen by the studio because they wanted them to be Irish, because they wanted the family unit to be a key component of the film, and they felt that an Irish family unit was the best possible one they could have, with the mother as the centrepiece and James Cagney's criminality as the thing that destroyed the family. But that was in 1931, as I said, the pre-code era. But as the American Catholic Church became more powerful, they actually became unhappy with some of these representations of Irish criminals. And so they lobbied to have Catholic priests, Irish Catholic priests, put into as major characters in films. And in the post-code era, to the extent where in 1938 you had a film, Shake Hands with the Devil, which again starred James Cagney. But the story of Shake Hands with the Devil was two boys grow up together in a Brooklyn neighborhood, one of Irish ethnicity. One becomes an Irish gangster, the other becomes a Catholic priest. That the Catholic priest side was seen as the purity and innocence of the old country, whereas the criminality and the gangster side was the bit of divilment and maybe a lot worse besides, you know, brutality and darkness. So they actually coexisted, but you're absolutely right. There didn't seem to have been the same level of opposition from the Irish diaspora. They did embrace it because, you know, he was the first great anti-heroes of cinema, James Cagney's character in The Public Enemy. So yeah, it was something that was embraced, I think, you're right.
There was a Jewish film called Hester Street, and that was about a couple who arrived from Eastern Europe to New York, and unfortunately they found that the man, the husband, he became very modern, and his wife remained with the old values. And so it ended up in the divorce. Did that happen with many Irish?
Yeah, well, I think the idea, I don't know about divorce, I think that would have been
or
a pretty...
Separation.
Well, I think that would have been... Well, a lot of the stories were separation, but usually they were resolved at the end, that they would come back together. But usually the reason for the separation was one would embrace the new values of the new world, while the other would be left behind somewhat. So in some of the films I discussed from, say, 1910, that period, a lot of the central themes there was values. One partner or one part of the couple losing the values and the other regaining them. And that loss of the values, that the core values of the home, would lead to ruin somewhere down the line. No, that music from the silent film?
Yes.
That's been added in. Yeah, I mean, at the time they wouldn't have had any sound whatsoever. So they're all generally, when you watch a silent film nowadays, all the music has been added down the years. You know.
Did you choose that music?
No. That was in the print. That print was it's a German print, but I'm not sure where the music came from. But it's all very similar sort of stuff.
Brian referred earlier to the mic as the conch.
The con shoulder has.
Sorry, I'm going to get it over there in time. Sorry about that. So it's at the back.
Question from the back?
Yes, please. Thank you. Thanks for the presentation. Could you comment, please, on where the notion of the exile was constructed or how it emerged from a set of economic circumstances that are not being addressed in these films?
Sorry, how would you
yeah,
mean?
Where did the notion of exile come in a world in which the great economic forces are driving emigration and it's not really a personal reaction to some overwhelming force?
I think in a lot of these earliest films, it was first of all just to create a vision of home that would be attractive to people to go and look at in the screens. I don't think in the crudest early forms they had any real capacity to, in any great detail, portray the economic climate, other than what we saw in that first scene with the harshness of the land, that the conditions were poor. I don't think they had the means to really portray the economic side of it, and exile was probably the most creatively appealing or easiest tool that they could use in the early years, certainly.
So, but you're still recognizing it as a tool?
Well, I think essentially you have to look at it as a tool, and especially that they wanted people to go and see the films, and so it's a way of appealing to an audience, to that they have to appeal. They were trying to attract people into the cinema, because at the time as well, cinema was a very untrusted medium. It wasn't something that people had any great faith in. It was something that was new and intriguing, but I think their first aim was to try and make people interested. And as Sidney Alcott himself said, people wanted to see the old country again. I don't think people would have been interested in going to see films about famine or about poverty. I think that's what they wanted to leave behind. I think that's the reason it starts with the idea of exile as something to dream about. It's a fantasy.
Escapism.
It's escape. Well, I think for years it was escapism. And if you look at The Quiet Man, I think the most probably convincing argument I would hear in favour of The Quiet Man is that The Quiet Man is escapism. It's not trying to portray Ireland as reality. It's portraying it as well as post-war. It's after the Second World War. So there was a desire to portray a world which people could connect with through their Irish heritage, which was charming, free of, divested of horror and divested of fears. I think that's probably the thing to remember about it, is that it was not necessarily trying to portray reality, but to try and portray something dreamlike.
One more question there.
No, it was just an observation, really, Paddy. I hadn't noticed it before. I don't know if anybody just noticed today, during the part of the score for The Quiet Man is very similar to parts of the Gone with the Wind score. I thought it was very obvious today. I just hadn't noticed it ever before. Of course, with Scarlett O'Hara being another Irish-American heroine.
I don't think it was the same person who composed it, but it's from the same studio, I think.
It's very, very,
yeah,
very,
the
very
same,
similar there. Just an observation. Yeah.
Interesting. I mean, is the extent to which it is used as a sort of way of enhancing the romanticism and the dreamlike nature? You could argue the same for 1939. I'll make a comment. I know there's one more question, and we'll leave it there. But just one of the things I thought was very interesting is, again, this, and it's been a theme that we've discussed, is the way in which Alcott, Ford, you might even argue through to Mary Black, is aware very much of the commercial exploitation of what they're doing, and that the dreamlike quality of what Ford produces is perfect in a way for the large Irish American audience, maybe Irish audience, but also other ethnic audiences in America, and its box office is what, you know, it really does deliver on that front. Final point is on Mary Black. What struck me in her song Remember Nadine in 1986, it used a terribly emotive phrase that would not be, I would say, if she wrote the song now, where it said young Irish people who turn their backs on Ireland. I mean, I would say if you were writing that song now, you'd put it the other way around. People for whom the country has turned the backs on them. Discuss.
I think. Well, I definitely think the narrative has definitely changed. If you look at the, you know, any of the media coverage, say in the Irish Times and RTE, or any of the media coverage of, say, emigration from 2008 on, necessitated emigration. It's almost exclusively, you know, that they've been let down by their country, and that the opportunity aren't there for them. I don't know how that happened, but it has happened. I don't know where along the line of change, but it definitely has.
Well, I was just going, it just became very obvious to me that these directors were very clear that they understood the power of the story, that it doesn't really matter whatever happened in the past, the story is all that lasts. And they have done that very well. For the American 5th, 6th, 7th generations are just as passionate about being part of their heritage or their country. And through these films and books, to the media, they've portrayed that story. Not the reality, but the story
but
is the last.
I think the films help to keep that. That's they're part of the reason for that. That they put those images down for people for all eternity, well, for whatever. That they put them there, that they become... It's like in the way... I know a lot of I've spoke to a lot of Italian Americans about this, that they actually idolise some of the characters in, say, The Sopranos and The Godfather as people to be actually sort of proud of.
Yes.
You know, because they're it's part of their culture in some small way, or... I don't know.
Sorry, this is sort of more of an aside than anything else. I'm interested perhaps more in the way things change or stay the same. And with ethnic characters, you quite often have stock characters who appear time and again. So today you'll have Colm Meaney, for example. Is there a value, do you think, in maybe looking at the careers of specific individuals who are perceived to be Irish or Irish-American characters, and then how their portrayals of the stock Irish-American character or Irish character develops over time in their career, perhaps, as an issue?
Definitely, yeah. It's definitely worth looking at. I mean, James Cagney, you could devote a conference to James Cagney's role as an Irish-American actor, the characters he's played. Absolutely, and I mean, the idea of a typecast actor, at what point do they become typecast, and at what point does the character start to evolve? Yeah, you could certainly devote great study to that. I mean, James Cagney has, for example, has prompted a lot of detailed studies, and how, for example, he ended up playing in the 1950s. He played predominantly Irish-American gangsters in the early part of his career. But by the 1950s, he actually played a veteran IRA man in Shake Hands with the Devil, which was set in Ireland. So his portrayal of an Irish-American gangster with no actual direct connection to Ireland evolved into him actually playing an Irishman with a criminal element. So yeah, certainly.
Okay, and Sir Peter, I think you have a comment or?
Yeah, just one, and it is a comment rather than a question or anything like that. But Maureen O'Hara was mentioned and shown. I knew that family. Fitzsimmons was the name of the family. And her younger brother, Timmy Fitzsimmons, I used to play poker with. I remember at the other place, not your place, UCD, the other place. And I bet I was also met Maureen O'Hara in connection with a charity which we had, the O'Reilly thing about, in America. And the last time I saw her, and I see she died actually quite recently in her 90s, the last time I saw her, I was speaking to her, and I said, "How did your brother Jimmy do?" He was Jimmy, and they say, they had a hat shop in Westminster Street, the Fitzsimmons. Jimmy did nothing that I ever saw, or anybody ever saw, except play poker, flip around at Dublin and go from one bar to some other bar to another. He said, "Oh, Jimmy has emigrated to you." And I said, "Well, how did he do?" "Extremely well. Jimmy's a millionaire now, away out on the San Francisco coast." And I thought, well, there are good things from emigration.
Absolutely. So she was every bit as feisty in real life.
That's a commercial episode, I knew.
Well, on that note, and we don't know if the seeds of that millionaire status had begun at a poker table somewhere between UCD and TCD, but we'll put it down to the enterprise later experienced on the west coast of America. Just to wind up and to thank very much the speaker today, Arthur, I think has really given us tremendous insight and covered a lot of ground in a very accessible way for everybody, and we're very, very grateful for him, because I know there's a lot of work that goes into preparing it, and all the technology held together and worked, and it was a beautifully delivered presentation. So Arthur, many, many thanks from us.